Good morning, Comrade Ojondo.
Good morning.
My name
Good
is
morning to you.
Anibaba Fatima. Please, can you introduce yourself?
I'm Ojango Omondi, from Kenya, a member of the Social Justice Working Group. This is a consortium of community-based organizations advocating for social justice and fighting for human rights. I'm a community organizer. By profession, I'm an interior designer and a Kenyan revolutionary, a member of the Revolutionary Socialist League.
It's good to have you on here. Thank you for joining us.
Pleasure joining too.
Can you explain the key issues that have led to the recent protests in Kenya?
To begin with, we had a finance bill that first went through public participation for people to give their views and insight about it. And basically, as Kenyans, we were not happy about the taxations. There were punitive taxes that were imposed on us at these crucial economic times. And through the public participations, Kenyans gave their views and say that they don't want that finance bill. They wanted it to be reviewed. Unfortunately, the people elected to represent the people decided to stand with the executive and pass the bill. And from that, it's when Kenyans say that we are no longer again accepting this. We told the president to reject the bill and not to amend. And this protest, though we'll say the finance bill was the trigger, but many factors have contributed to this. One is the high employment rates, the rising cost of living, and political disillusionment. Young people make up that significant portion of the population. We feel marginalized and frustrated by the lack of economic opportunities and the corruption within the government. And also with our leaders show us opulence and they live in luxury as many of us live in poverty. And by us refusing the finance bill, we saw it as us financing their livelihoods and their standard of living. The resources that we receive, even the loans that we receive, they are used not for the benefit of the people. They are used for these politicians and government officials to buy high-ended vehicles for their spouses, for to buy houses for themselves, whereas many Kenyans cannot afford food. Kenyans cannot afford better educations. Our hospitals are at a bad state. So with us rejecting the finance bill, we said, no, we want a government that serves for us. Secondly, we have had a lot of police brutality. And with that, because people, Kenyans were peaceful while they were protesting. The Constitution gives us the right to protest. Article 37 of the Kenyan Constitution says that we as a people, we are allowed to protest peacefully and armed. But the police used a brutal force. Many people were killed, many were injured, and having people being kidnapped. So Kenyans are hungry. They want a change of system and a government. They want a government that can listen to them.
Thank you very much for giving us an overview of what the situation is like over there in Kenya. What are the main demands and grievances of the protesters?
So, for us, one, we want economic reform to address the unemployment and the high cost of living. Because currently, many graduates, they finish school, and mark you, our education system is so expensive. And when you bear the cost of going through the education system, you find yourself unemployed. And with that, also you need also to pay taxes, whether you are employed or unemployed. So another opportunity, we want accountability and transparency in government operations to combat corruption, because what has been eating us as a country is the madness of corruption. People are stealing public funds. People are stealing even loans that we are given. So we as Kenyans are demanding accountability and transparency in the government operation. We are also calling for a reform in the police to end brutality and ensure justice for all victims, those who were killed, those who were abducted during the protest. And we want the police inspector to resign because he has failed to honor the constitution and the rule of law. And also, we want increased opportunity for the youths in employment and education. And as a people, we are demanding for better living standard. We are fighting for better housing, better health care, proper education, better social security. So we are advocating for our social economic rights. And also we are, as a people, realizing the rot in our political system. We want an overhaul. That's why we are saying we are 3 years away from the elections. So it's time for us to reform our political and democratic processes and to ensure proper and fair representation. And with this, we want the Independent Electoral and Boundary Commission to be established. Remember, even after 2 years of the president coming to power, after the officials of the Independent and Electoral Boundary Commission, some of them resigned and some of them were removed because of the happenings during the elections. Since then, the president hasn't established or hasn't commissioned the Independent Electoral and Boundary Commission. So we are demanding for that commission to be formed. Yesterday, the president signed into law the bill to commission the Independent Electoral Boundary Commission. And with that, we start the process of recalling and also organizing when it comes to 2027, we elect leaders who are accountable and are ready to rule and serve the people, not to rule, but to serve the people.
How has the Kenyan government responded to the protests so far, and what is your assessment of their handling of the situation?
To me, it's very disappointing that the government needs to kill its people so that it starts listening to them. The killings, the abductions that happened, the threats, the deaf ears the government gave to Kenyans wasn't a response befitting a government elected by the people just 2 years after the elections. So the response has included a mixture of forceful crackdowns. And the police have been deployed to disperse and kill protesters. There is a lot of intimidations. There are a lot of propagandas. The government has gone to the extent of even hiring goons to loot property and destroy property so as to discredit our protest. And I would say this is uncalled for, because we as a people, as a country, we have a social contract that we signed with the government, the constitution, that must be honored. It guarantees the people the right to protest, the right to have peaceful assemblies. But during these processes, our people have been kidnapped. Now bodies are being retrieved from our dams and rivers. And most of these people were at the protest when we said we are occupying the parliament. And I condemn this, and it's so unfortunate. But it's a awakening call for us as a people that come next election, or when we are elect our leaders, we need to have accountable leaders. So I would say currently the government is calling for dialogues. And as a people, we have said that no, we don't need dialogues for us to have the constitutions respected. We don't need to have dialogues and discuss issues of employment. We don't need to have dialogues to talk about reforms in the police. So I think the government is thinking the opposite direction. The tactic the government are using are outdated, whereby when issues arises that needs actions, instead of the government responding by taking actions, they form commissions,